Good afternoon. I'm Scott Reed. I'm president here at the Music Academy of the West, and I'm thrilled to welcome you all to this very special masterclass featuring the concertmaster of the New York Philharmonic, Frank Huang. Frank is, Frank is very special to the Music Academy of the West because he is an alumnus of our program. He attended the Music Academy in 1998 and 1999, where he studied here with Kathy Winkler, our wonderful violin faculty. Frank became the concertmaster of the Houston Symphony in 2010, and in 2015, after a comprehensive international search, he succeeded one of our other violin faculty members, the great Glenn Dictereau, and became the concertmaster of the New York Philharmonic. We're so pleased that Frank is here with us this week, working with our fellows, giving private lessons, and today we get to see him teach a master class on our stage, which is an honored moment for the Music Academy of the West. I do want to mention that today's master class is dedicated to our good friends, Dorian and Peter Hirth, and And I also want to acknowledge two special people. Frank is here as part of our partnership with the New York Philharmonic that was made possible by our lead sponsors, Mike and Linda Keston. Now, please help me join to the stage Music Academy alumnus, concertmaster of the New York Philharmonic, Frank Huang.
If I'm supposed to say anything else, but thank you, Scott. Really happy to be back here. It's been a couple years. Last time I was here, I think I was playing a benefit concert on this stage, if I remember correctly. So it's nice to be back. Nice to see everybody, a lot of familiar faces. So we have some Dvorak concerto coming up.
Thank you.
great playing. So this is you guys could probably tell, it's a tough piece. It's a very difficult piece. A lot of passage work, a lot of double stops, all the things that violinists love and hate at the same time. It's a fun piece to play though, right? Are you enjoying working on this piece? Have you performed it before? First time. How did it feel to play it in front of people?
So nervous?
Okay. So that's something we deal with a lot, right? Getting nervous when there's people in front of us playing somehow very different than in the practice room, right? What do you feel is the most different when you're nervous? What happens in a way? Like, do you feel like you have less control, or do you feel like you...
Hard to control the bow.
Hard to control the bow, right? Okay. So when we get nervous, what are some things that... You perform a lot, obviously, as a violinist. You have to deal with this all the time, right? So let's just start with that. We'll talk about this a little bit throughout the class. What are some things you can do to help you relax and not be so nervous? What do you think? What can you do? Like, let's say you walk out on stage, you see all these people, they're excited to see you play, but you feel very nervous. What do you do? Do you just kind of try to power through it, or do you have any tricks that you like to do? No.
I don't think.
Okay. So that's often the case. We just, even if we're nervous, we're like, okay, we have to get out there, we have to play. For me personally, it helps a lot if we put a lot of the pressure on the music. So whether the performance is successful or not, it all depends on how committed we are to making the music tell a good story or have a lot of character. That makes it less about whether everything's in tune or whether everything's clean. The technical part of it, I think, is very easily influenced when we're nervous. We lose a little bit of control, we get a little bit tighter. So first of all, talking about physical, the way that we play. Can I see you hold up your violin for a second? Okay, you don't need your bow arm, just put up your violin for a second, okay? Quick question for you. When you hold up your violin, do you feel like your head is holding your violin, or do you feel like your body is supporting your violin? Your head is holding it. It looks like that a little bit, and that's normal. It's an awkward instrument, right? Those of you that don't, I'm assuming some of you don't play violin. So it's kind of one of the hardest things when you're learning how to play violin is how to hold the instrument, right? So when I see you playing, the reason I notice this a lot is when people play, they often put up the violin and hold it like this, right? Which is the proper way to do it, but it makes all these muscles kind of working like hard all the time, right? So try this, it's a subtle difference, but hold up your violin, and instead of going down to hold it, feel like your body is like supporting your instrument up into your head, right? Okay, how does that feel? Does that feel different? It looks a little different.
Yeah.
Try. Yeah. Okay. Can you? Let's just for an experiment. Let's just try the opening, and we'll talk about a few things. And this may help you next time you get a little nervous when you're performing. We'll talk about a few things you can do. One, the first thing is making sure you're always well supported. You don't want to feel like you're holding too much, like with this muscle here. Okay. So can you just try the beginning, like right where? Yeah. The very beginning. You can do the tutti. Yeah. And let's see what happens. You feel very big. What is the character of this opening? What do you want? What is the mood, kind of? It's very lyrical, very singing. But there's some kind of dramatic quality, right? You're like trying to create this turbulent, this kind of dark character, right? How do you want your articulation to sound? Do you want Bayam or Toyam, rounder, right? So I thought, we're getting into specific things now. I don't want to get into specific things until we talk about the body thing, but just for the beginning, just think about how you want the character to be round and very lyrical as you're saying. Avoid any like accents or sharp accents. Save those for the accented notes later. Okay, let's try. Thank you. Let's just talk about a few things one second. It sounds great. I mean, you know, we could get into a little bit of the specifics. Let's see if this can give the audience a different idea of the character. So you have this opening theme. How does it feel, by the way, if you feel like a little bit supported? Does it feel different or not really? Tiny bit? Okay. It takes a while to get used to this idea. But when you play the beginning, if you were singing it, for example, there's very little, you're creating a long line, right? And you're doing that quite well. But I notice that every time you have a long note, it does seem like it decays a little bit, right? So it sounds like and that maybe is okay, but even then you can think about a long line just sustaining through the longer shapes. But here, when the crescendo starts, it's especially important. You don't do then it sounds like three separate phrases. So crescendo through the half notes, right? Let's try one more time. We'll talk about a few things. The next thing I want to ask you is how you're cueing yourself. Are you breathing before you play your first entrance or no? No? Yeah? No. Or you're not thinking about it really, right? Okay. So that's another thing that I think is very strange is normally when we're walking around, you know, in our daily lives, we don't often think about how we breathe or whether we're breathing or not. We just know we are breathing or else we, you know, would be passed out or worse. So your job in a way, especially when you're nervous, breathing is like the number one thing that can help you. Okay, so that's what I was trying to get at earlier when I was asking if there's anything you can do. Make sure you're breathing really, really well. How would you breathe before you start this entrance to give yourself the right character? Do you breathe in or do you breathe out before you play?
Breathe in.
Can you try? Let's experiment. Try. Just think about how you're breathing before you play. let's take away the orchestra. Can you just play the opening? Just by yourself? Can you try once where you breathe out before you play? So, right? So breathe out in the way that you want the character to sound. Rich, warm, round. So, can you try? Is it really weird? So, okay, how we breathe is very important. And that's something you should start thinking about all the time. Am I cueing myself in the right way? Am I giving myself different places would call for different ways of breathing according to how you cue yourself. A sharp note, like a chord, for example, you would breathe kind of quickly, like out like that. So you give yourself the energy always. I kind of think of it as breathing in the character that you want to play. The reason this is important is because A, it makes sure you're thinking about your breathing, and B, it allows your body to kind of release all this tension. If you go, I feel like I'm holding all this tension and I'm trying to play at the same time. Does that make sense? So do that like one or two more times just to make sure you get the idea. Think about how you want the note to sound, the warmth, the roundness, and then see if your cue can reflect that a little bit. super tricky, super tricky. That was good. I heard a little bit of exhaling. That's good. Yeah. And keep breathing. Now the crescendo starts. 2, 3, 4, 1. 2, 3, 4. Right. Now it starts. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1. And okay. So this is like a lot of people treat this as kind of a cadenza, right? And I think that's okay. It should have this freedom and this rubato to make it sound very virtuosic at the end. But at the same time, timing is something, for me, it always makes more sense when it's organic. So if you can subdivide it, even if it's moving around like crazy, it's okay, it's good. If you can't subdivide it into a understandable subdivision, it can sound very weird. Like whenever I hear this piece, if I don't know it, I feel like it is a cadenza, right? And can you try improvising it, but within an organic kind of shape? So, it's everything, even the forward or back, either way, it feels like it's on the string of the bass rhythm being, can you try? How about from the crescendo? And really do a crescendo through the long notes. Feel the tension. 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Are you breathing during that last bar? Maybe not. So those are the places. The harder something is, the more difficult something is, the more likely you are to hold your breath, right? That's true in everything we do in normal life. If you're like lifting something heavy, if you're doing something strenuous mentally, you're concentrating, holding our breath is the first thing that happens. And unfortunately for violinists, that translates to all sorts of physical problems. You get tight, our muscles don't get enough oxygen, and then you're like, why doesn't this feel as good as when I'm practicing, you know, like when you're by yourself. Can you try, let's just do this for a second, slowly, and try to figure out a way to breathe normally, not the shallow breaths that you're probably taking when you're playing, deep breaths, normal breaths. Better, already. One other question. Do you see how many accents are starting from where you started until the high note? How many accents are there in this whole two bars?
Two.
Two, which two?
Eight.
Can you show the audience where the two accents are and conversely show them where there aren't any other accents? So you see what's happening, right? Each bow change, it's becoming a little bit like ya da 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 da, and then when the accents come, it sounds like, okay, you're being forceful on those two notes, but it doesn't feel like it's because it's building tension and the accents are changing the character. Can you try even smoother on the bow changes? Good, already better. So you want the accents to sound like they're actually a result of this huge crescendo, and this lyrical character is getting so agitated that it's becoming a sharper character. So that's articulation. The reasons they're there is not so that you know where to put accents and where to not put accents. It's so that you have an idea of what the character is doing. The thing that could make this even more exciting and the accents even more justifiable is if you do more crescendo at the end when it's written. So this bar has a ton of crescendo. And this bar, I feel like you're almost already there. Do you know what I mean? So if you pace this, can you save the most crescendo for these two beats? So the accents, and then the first accent, ya-ta-yum. So even the second accent should be more than the first accent, right? Within the crescendo. Just carefully pace that. Let's try one more time. Better, better. That shift, can I just see you do that big shift once from a good angle? Okay, so it looks like to me a little bit like as you're getting ready for this shift, your left shoulder, you're doing, you're kind of like squeezing it up to you're like, oh, something's hard coming up, let's get a little bit tense and see if we can get there. Try to keep your shoulders open. Like, remember the idea of holding your, having your violin supported up? Keep that. Can I see, like, let me just see you put your arm down again. Take a deep breath. Like really deep breath. Okay, you feel relaxed? You feel like your violin is stable? I see you trying to protect it. Yeah, it's okay, right? Okay, so when you feel really supported, like the violin should feel like it's very comfortable in a way. That's super important. You don't want to feel like you, keeping this idea, again, keeping your shoulders very open, keeping yourself, this is a huge character here, right? This is like super brilliant, super dramatic. If you were this person, you would be like 800 pounds. You would be this giant, right? Can you imagine that you're this huge person? So, ya-da-da-ya-tum. Feel like you're expanding in your stature. Don't feel like you're getting more closed off, right? One last time. So keep singing. Okay, okay. One more time, just do the shift. Which hand is leading on the shift? Left hand? Okay. I don't know, I'm asking you. How do you feel? So when you shift up, are you feeling like your left hand is very supported up here on the high note? It feels like when you get up there, you're not totally in a comfortable position. Can I just see you do the shift slowly once? Okay, one more. Did you play the high note? Aha. Do you see this tiny space between the string and the fingerboard or no? Is that how you play up high? Like, do you ever like, can you press the note down all the way? Yeah, even kind of deeper into the fingerboard? Yeah, maybe are your strings really high? Okay, yeah, that's maybe part of the issue. The E string, for those of you that don't play violin, super thin, very, very sharp. If you press down on it very hard, it can cut your fingers sometimes. I mean, we have calluses because we play all the time. But when your bridge is really high, that can happen. But here's the downside. If you don't block the note well, if you don't cover the note all the way down to the fingerboard, it's very hard to get a rich, solid sound. So that could be an instrument thing. You might need to just shave your bridge tiny bit. But it looks like you should be able to get, yeah. That's already better, yeah. You want that core in the sound. So you don't block things totally well. And I noticed that with your fast notes, some of your passage work, if you ever notice that it's not quite like crystal clear, every single note, it could be that your left hand is a little bit on the lazy side, blocking the fast notes. I see this a lot, actually. Super fast notes, we'll pick a place. It's very tempting to feel like you just kind of play the notes a little bit. But in a way, you have to feel like you're springing off of the fingerboard a little bit. Let's pick one of these places. Even here, I would think you need to be a little more well blocked. Okay, let's jump a little bit. Let's jump to a little different section. Let's jump to this. Yum, yum. Yeah, exactly. Right there. Stay supportive. So some of these fast scales, I just wanted to see, these are not the ones that need blocking. I think those are more like runs like these, right? These sounded pretty good to me. And these chords, somehow now you're paying a little more attention to how your body feels. I feel like you're getting a little more ring in the sound. I feel like when you try to play loud, like really big, what do you think needs to happen? How do you play something really loud?
Use more bow and pressure.
Okay, so this is something that I always am curious about, because when people think about playing louder, a lot of times people think that we have to press more, right? Or press harder, which in a way is true. You need a lot of weight, right? But like, let's say for right now, I have a ton of weight down, but it's not making any sound, right? So in a way, the strings, they don't move up and down, right? The strings go this way, right? So if you think about it that way, the more the string goes this way, the more it's gonna ring out, right? So yes, you need a lot of weight, but it's always how much pull and pushing you get that creates the sound, right? So that's something I feel like for you, you could really think about a little bit, is when you're trying to play loud, is not just adding weight, but adding this feeling of pulling and pushing into your string. So that way you don't add accents where you don't want them. That happens quite a bit. There's so many accents here, but then there's so many other places where there aren't accents. So again, just being very careful about that. If you articulate something, it's on purpose. Even more importantly, let's just talk about the second theme for a second, just so we don't run out of time. How do you feel about singing in front of people? It says sing right here. It says sing. Have you ever sang in front of an audience before? Would you be uncomfortable if I asked you to sing a little bit? You don't have to. But maybe, how do you feel?
I'm bad at singing.
You're bad at singing, okay. I was bad at singing too, but now I do it all the time. I can't stop doing it. So I'll sing for you, okay? So here, you're doing dum tia ya da ya da ya. So where does the dim start, and then how do you think it should lead into this character? Right? The dim should start right away, you think?
Dim up.
Like the diminuendo. Like, you see how it's marked only here?
Yeah.
Right? Can you just, this is a hard place to start. Can you just play tiyam, tiyayadam, and sing all the way through until the big triplet? You know what I mean? So don't let the sound die too much, and then do a nicer dim at the end of the phrase. And your triplet is oddly, it sounds like there's a 5-4 bar in the last bar. Ti ya dum ya da ya da dum. Right? You can take time, but you can't make it sound like it's suddenly a 5-4 bar, right? The dim can help you, saving the dim for that. Can you try it right on the hard spot? 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 1 and. Sorry, just to pick on this a little bit. Have we seen any marking of dolce yet in this piece?
No,
right? And what does dolce mean, just for the people that may not know yet what it means?
Sweet.
Dolce, close. Think like ice cream or like sweet, yeah. So dolce, is a marking that, especially in a piece like this, where everything's angular and maybe more vertical in feeling, when you suddenly have something dolce and slurred on top of that, it should be, the audience should be like, wow, this is such a new color, such a new texture. There should be something magical about it. Can you just play this theme? And in the vibrato, in the bow speed, just without orchestra, let's just get this right color for a second. Just right on it. And again, breathe. Give yourself a very like dolce breath out. Now, for the audience, do you guys get a sense that this is like the sweetest, most tender character, or could there be even more sweetness? Maybe more sweetness. This is just to get what the audience, it's often very hard, sometimes even if we think we're doing something, for someone that doesn't know the piece maybe, or doesn't know that it's marked, or for whatever reason, it needs to be really moving, more convincing. Can you try once? I'm not sure how I would try to do it, but. So. Something about the shift too. Can you try to. To make the vibrato very singing, so the shift, even though you have to shift, it's still part of this smooth singing. I'm not quite getting the right character either, but try to get it as tender and sweet as possible. Better. One more question. How much bow do you need if it's very tender and soft? I notice you're always using your whole bow, right? Which is nice sometimes. Can you try to restrict your bow a little bit so you feel like... There's technically no crescendo, right? Of course, you can phrase a little bit. But can you try once to keep it a little more suspended? Now, the second question is, how does this relate to this? Is it the same, or is it a little bit darker? Is it a little bit brighter? A little darker. So if your first one, this... So, for example, these kinds of places, when you have... If you use too much bow, I feel like it makes the sound jump up a little bit. So just be a little bit careful of your bow distribution. And then save some of the bow speed for... So that it's darker, so you have that room to make it darker when you want that color to be different, right? You can be softer too if you want to be darker on the second half of that phrase, right? One more time. Save your bow, right? Now go to the frog. Make sure you keep that suspense going so that this crescendo, it feels like it's very mysterious, and then this darkness kind of building, you know what I mean? So it's all about how convincing these characters can be. Let's just try to get into this once from the same heart spot again, and then super dolce right away. Let's get this transition once with the orchestra. I think we have to let the next person go, but just a few basic things for you to remember. support yourself well. Don't feel like you're holding your violin too much. Feel like your shoulders are very open, you're very supportive, and breathe all the time, no matter what you're playing. And experiment with this cueing yourself, giving yourself the energy with the breath out of whatever character you're playing. I think it'll help you be more comfortable. Yeah, but great job. Thank you. Beautiful, beautiful.
Thank you.
Have you performed this before? First time also?
I learned it 2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago, okay, brand new. All right. Very, very good start. And you know, as you get more comfortable with it, I'm sure it'll be even more interesting and you know, exciting. It's already on the way there. Let's just talk about a few things. This is a tricky opening, right? Let's just talk about the opening for 1 second. Can you just show us the very beginning? This is like, maybe out of all the Beethoven sonatas, I think the hardest one to start. You're by yourself, you got these weird chords, right? Let's just talk about it for 1 second. Can you just try the opening? Now, just to make sure we're all on the same page, after the first note is obviously forte, right? Then you have this dim. The second note already within piano. Can I hear, is Minju? Can I hear your answer to that theme once, just the very beginning? Piano has a easier way to get the subito piano because they just have to play softer on the second chord. For us, it's also, can you show me, let me see your, from a good angle what you're doing to get to that second chord. Uh-huh, uh-huh. So are you trying to get to the D more comfortable, or are you thinking more in first position or more in second position?
More
in second position, right? That's, I think that's the right way to do it. Can I just see you do? Just a few times. And make sure you change the color. Right, one more time. Right, so think of how the piano answers you. Very sweet in a way, right? After the second. Right. Okay, so two suggestions. One is, as long of a line as you can make, the bowing, like splitting the second bar, I think is also okay if you do it very smoothly. But another option is, and then these two chords. Actually, too much crescendo, right? Your gesture is different than the piano. The piano has this idea of like thinking that you're going somewhere and then backing off. You don't really have to worry about that. So maybe not too much excitement towards the end. Can you try that bowing once? So I mean, ideally, if we could do it, we would do it. But that's super uncomfortable, right? It's very awkward. But maybe two notes and then two notes also can help. The idea is you want it to be smoother, like in the piano. Okay. Are you breathing before your first chord? So you always feel like there's this pulse leading you. One last time, and then, so the first one, even if it's a little broader, do yom, and three, and one, and two. I still feel like it sounds like yom, ba, ba, right? Super sustained. It to you. Right, where you're passing it, you're not ending the phrase so much, right? That's better already. Can you go on? Can you come in and then let's do the rest of this intro? And there's a super weird dim for one 16th note. Yata yata. Can you try to take advantage of that? He took a lot of effort to write that decrescendo on that one note, right? We should do something. So all of this, I don't know if you get the idea, the feeling that the subdivided super strong pulse goes all the way through, even though it's so fragmented, but you're trying to create this. It's like you have this idea, but you're very hesitant about it, you know? Like you're always questioning, am I doing the right thing? But you're walking towards the direction, but you're always questioning yourself, but there's this direction all the way through. So that creates this nice long line, even though it's fragmented, right? That's enough about the opening, just so you get the idea. So as you guys play off of each other and try to keep this line going all the way through, at the very end, it's like you get close to your destination and then something suddenly makes you feel like you weren't supposed to do that, right? So the very end, you're so close. Yata, yata. It feels very mysterious almost, or something happened to change your mind, right? Let's talk about this presto now. You guys had a couple of different tempos. As you went, I don't know, have you guys talked about what your ideal tempo is? basically there's the tempo you started, and there's like a faster tempo when you guys get to this stuff, right? And it stayed mostly on the faster side afterwards. Do you guys like the faster tempo, or you like the slower tempo?
I think I started too slow.
Too slow.
Yeah.
How are you gonna get the right tempo? as you're holding this, how are you gonna get the right tempo? You know what I mean?
Prepare,
yes. but you have to kind of sing it already, right? Do y'all? You know what the cue? Maybe it doesn't have to be that fast, but I kind of like this a little bit on the, it is presto. It's not allegro, it's not, it's not a normal fast marking, right? Let's not go too crazy, but can you guys try it a little bit, just the last phrase, and then get into a slightly faster presto. Can you just do the presto one more time? Right on it. Now we have a tempo. Now, as you get louder, you're getting a little bit longer, right?
Mm-hmm.
That may be okay. I don't think that's necessarily a bad idea, but again, don't think about the dots. They could get longer, but don't make it sound like there's no more dots, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Can you keep the same idea? There could be a little more energy. There's a little more intensity in the dotted notes. You know what I mean? This could be a little more serious somehow. Can you try? Yeah. One and two and one and two and. First time you guys played, is the last note piano? It's still in fortissimo, right? Yeah, can you do that? That run sounded awesome. One more time. Okay. As this goes, this is a sforzando. This is the dynamic.
Mm-hmm.
What is this one? It's for thunder, right?
Right.
Okay, so, so you have the... You know what I mean? So this first one, for thunder, forte, and then it's for thunder within the forte.
Right?
I don't quite get that yet. It needs to sound, the sforzandos need to be like they need a lot of energy. And let's try one more time. That, when that last note is boom, and then you're creating all this energy. It should almost surprise the audience that it starts in this soft character. You do the run one more time, it sounds so good. Opposite. You're doing da 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 da. Right? This is, try not to accent the down bow.
Mm-hmm.
Super big accent on the up bow. Okay. Okay. Just run on it. And two and one. Pass it back and forth. to, so these chords, can I just see you do your chords by yourself? Yum, bum. So what is the difference between, why aren't there terzandos on all of them? Should there be?
No.
No. That's an artistic call. Maybe you think that they should all be the same. How can you make them different? What do you think?
I have to make a phrase.
Okay. Let's pick one of the terzando ones. This first one. Can you just play that one? The terzando one. Yeah. Uh-huh. Can you breathe a little bit before you play? Like. So maybe these could be slightly longer, and then the non-terzando ones could be slightly shorter. I don't want to take away from the energy, mm-hmm. but we need to tell that there's something extra heavy about the terzando ones. Mm-hmm. Yeah. About the difference between the terzando and non-terzando, but I do care about the difference that this time they all have terzandos. Mm. That's the main difference. It doesn't really matter if you make a huge deal here, but this needs to sound like it's heavier. You know what I mean? So this. Have more like a pop to it and then sustain. Mm-hmm. It sounds a little bit like, instead of, you know what I mean? So hit it super hard the way you're doing, but then try to keep the energy, mm-hmm. or else it feels like it's not as exciting. It's pretty exciting. It could be more exciting. Right on the forte, what bar is that? Section by herself before? Have you ever done that?
No.
Can you just show her all the stuff that's going on? She's just like worried about these little chords. Can you show what's like really happening? Yeah. By yourself. Because our parts are pretty easy, you have this tendency, you're just like, okay, let's just go. And I feel like you're kind of throwing her under the bus a little bit. Let her lead with the stability, and you're just trying to like enforce the excitement that she's already building. And these terzandos, I hear them a lot from her, but I don't hear them from you. Can I just hear this? You're doing down bow, right? Have you ever tried opposite? Yeah. I think maybe somehow sharper. Either way. Better. Can you do it a little bit slower? Can I say? You know what it is? Don't think of it as a sforzando. Really think of it as a character. Yum, bum, 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 bum. Like, I feel like you're thinking, oh, there's a sforzando. I should accent the second beat. you don't think of it as a sforzando. Think about that's the character. It's yan, zong, bom, bom, bom. You know what I mean? You have to make it like part of the character, or else if you think of it as a dynamic, it's never gonna be as convincing in a way, right? The point of it is to give this character, right? So I feel like also your left hand, can I just see you do that again? Better. So as you're playing this with your left hand, can you imagine that the fingerboard is like a, it's not a soft material, it's very hard, right? But if you imagine that it's kind of springy, and your left hand is like, every note is kind of bouncing off of the fingerboard, so it goes a little deeper, but then it releases a little bit quicker. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, I feel like you're kind of working hard to play the notes, but try to have a little bit more springiness in the left hand. Don't work too hard, but let the fingers bounce off of the fingerboard. Mm-hmm. Let's see if that helps. Let's try. Better, a little cleaner. So when you play fast notes, sometimes it doesn't help to try to like hit the notes harder, but if you kind of keep your left hand springy and very bouncy, it can create the articulation that you need. Now the up bow accents are better. You may want to try them down bow. I happen to think the up bow, you get a sharper accent, mm-hmm. right? Let's try, what's a good place where we can put this together? How about yam ba daryam? Right there. What, 73? Uh-huh. So one and two and. All of this stuff, the... I feel like when you play soft, you... How do you feel about your contact point when you're playing soft? Right. Can you try this the dolce part? Very soft and very sweet, but still with a lot of core, like not too far away. Can you see what that feels like? Just right on the dolce. So, yeah. Crescendo can go pretty far. Like you have this idea, and can you just play those chords with me once, the first one? You see how that builds so much tension through the, you're holding the note, but the modulations are making it so dark in a way, right? This first one doesn't have to be so loud when the crescendo starts. I'm not sure about changing the color in the middle. It may not be necessary. It's a nice idea, but it might be nice just to have the whole color right away on the G if you wanted to, right? Mm-hmm. How are we doing on time? We probably have to, okay. Nobody's warning me, I'm just going by. Sorry to get stuck up on the. Thank you. Michelle. That's a better angle. Thank you.
Performed that before? Oh, you have performed that before, okay.
Okay, so let's just talk about a few small things. I have a question for you. How do you feel about your tempo? Is this your normal tempo? It's fast?
I play on the fast side, I know.
Okay, I think, if anything, it felt like you were trying to hold yourself because maybe you've been told that it's on the fast side. I don't mind it on the fast side, and I felt like occasionally you got to a really comfortable tempo for you. But then every time the opening came, I felt like, again, you were trying to hold it. And so the reason it's not good to play too fast, anybody want to guess why? It's not that it's harder, faster. In a way, it's the same thing, right? We're talking about a few notches, right? The dangerous thing about playing it too fast is that you lose the clarity, right? You want to hear all the fast notes. One way you could help with your clarity in the fast section, can I just hear you play the yup-ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba, just the main thing? Without orchestra, just like that. It's a little bit under. Let me just see what's happening. Do you notice that sometimes there's like a little bit of like extra sound, right? A little bit, right? How could we make it more full of just clean pitch and none of this extraneous noise? What do you think? Do you know why it's happening, kind of, or no?
I feel like my bow is kind of skating past the string.
A little bit. In general, your stroke that you're using, I can't tell if you're deciding to make it more off or more on. It's a little bit in between, yeah. Right? That's what you're going for,
yeah.
Right? In the faster tempo, it might be worth it to experiment with a shorter stroke. And it is dotted, I think, right?
Yeah.
Anyways, can you try it a little bit under? Let me just see what your left hand also looks like. So, yum, ba da da ba 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 da 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 da. Basic idea to think about. Can you try the same thing and as much effort as you're putting into thinking about how your stroke is, can you put that energy into your left hand? And again, this idea of having it be more springy and more bouncy, not working harder. Don't try to play the notes harder, but have them spring off of the fingerboard more and try to, if anything, relax this a little bit more. Can you try once? I'm just curious. You're not kind of moving your bow around so much, just in one place. Yeah, very, very crisp, clean. Yeah. Yeah, but don't work too hard. Just yeah, a little bit closer to the bridge, tiny bit. Yeah, try to get it like super like loud and clear. You try that stroke, so let that stay relaxed and put all of your energy into your left hand being very bouncy. All of the short notes, sometimes I feel like if it's just a note that you're bouncing off of with your bow, that you feel like your left hand can be a little more relaxed on that. Yeah. Yeah, better. Yeah. So you don't want any of those small notes to be relaxed in your left hand in a way. Oh. Always articulated, always springy. And that stroke in the slightly faster tempo is gonna be cleaner. Are you guys hearing a little bit more of the notes slightly? A little bit less of the extraneous noise, right? So I think some of that is coming just from your stroke being a little bit kind of moving around too much in your bow. Later, you know, in the louder places where you want to be totally on the string, I think it's okay also. But again, that same, don't use too much bow. Just keep it very focused, you know what I mean? You don't want to have that those sounds interfere with your pitches. Your opening, can I see that? Can you try the very beginning? Again, without orchestra. Good. Same common theme for today is breathing. Are you thinking about how you're breathing, how you're cueing yourself? It sounds great.
Yeah.
With your nose?
Through my nose.
Through your nose? Okay. That's fine. We have that ability to breathe through our nose. So it looks to me like you're getting a good amount of sound, and it sounds like, you know, the right character. But if you give yourself, again, try to breathe out. Are you breathing in or breathing out? You're breathing out. But can you do it in a way where you're giving yourself a little more energy? So you have that kind of energy as you breathe. Yeah? Does that feel weird?
No.
No? Okay. I think it's pretty good. So you want that energy, but you want that kind of sustained quality afterwards, right? And then I think also your short notes. You want those high notes are hard to come out a little bit. Sometimes it sounds like, you know what I mean? You want to hear all the high notes. One more time. Yeah, the second one. You could really make it kind of like the second time you're saying something. Like, don't make me repeat it a third time. You know what I mean? Like very serious. Or else it feels like it's just a run-on part of the so it could be a more dramatic, I think. Yeah. Anyways, the chords, the C sharp is weirdly, yeah, you know what I mean? Like, are you trying to roll those?
No.
Don't. Yeah. As you go into, let's try the fast part with the orchestra. Right, a little faster and shorter. Does this tempo feel a little too fast for you? Okay. I kind of like it fast because it is supposed to be brilliant, right? Yeah. But what's impressive about this is if you make it very easy,
yeah.
If you make it seem like it's very easy.
Right.
The part that loses clarity is... You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It sounds like... Can you just play this? Yeah? Even before that. Yeah, that's a little bit better. You know what you're doing? You're giving more attention to your left hand. Don't worry about this. Let this just bounce. Yeah, yeah. So that's what I mean about your left hand. You have to make sure each note is blocked well and springy. If you're thinking about your right hand and you're trying to move this, your left hand has to lead. Mm-hmm. The reason it's a little bit fuzzy occasionally is your bow is moving without your left hand kind of being blocked and mm-hmm. ready to go, right? It's a small thing, but give your left hand more attention in terms of that energy, that kind of energy. The second theme, we'll just talk about it for a minute. Can we start right there? These upbeats, this kind of thickness, like you're, I don't know what kind of character you're thinking of. Can you kind of give us an idea what you're thinking?
Grand and
happy,
majestic.
Okay. So you think of it as kind of like a, is it on the brighter side or darker side?
I think it's on the
side.
Brighter.
On the brighter
side. And then it gets a little
side.
Darker with the piano.
I see. Okay, that's a totally different kind of way of thinking of the character. Like for me, it has the weight is what's important. Like
okay.
Like if this were a person in this character, like you're thinking of like kind of like a skinny happy person,
yeah,
whereas
a fat person,
right? Okay, it's definitely a huge person,
yeah.
Right? I think we can agree that it's a very big person. So in a way, the depth, the weight of it, I feel like it's not heavy enough in a way.
Oh, okay.
Right? You know what I mean? And then Dolly. That should be like a sweeter kind of maybe. It could still be darker, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
You know. But can you try once? Let's just go with this image of like a 600-pound person. Can you again give it that kind of character, even if he's happy. String,
mm-hmm.
Do you feel like you're kind of trapped in the upper half or no? It feels comfortable.
It feels okay.
It feels okay. I think you could experiment with when it goes on,
mm-hmm.
this. Instead of. I feel like you're working too hard.
Okay.
Again, it's not about the quality of the sound, it's about making it look and feel easy. Yeah? You don't wanna work too hard in this. The only other thing, let's have a minute to talk about, you know these little interruptions where you The orchestra has...
Whenever I hear this with orchestra, with the, have you played it with orchestra before?
No.
The very bottoms of those, it's always covered by the last chord of the orchestra. So it always sounds like... You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like you see the violinist come in, but then you don't hear it for a second, and then... So on those lower ones, can you really pop them out? And again, keeping this very compact bow closer to the bridge, a lot of energy in the left hand also block these chords very well. Can you just do the chord? Yeah. Yeah, that's a different one. do the first one, yeah, when it starts.
Oh, that is the first
one. B5. Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay, we're thinking of the end, right? But that's fine, let's just start there. Yep. Let me just hear it without the orchestra once, just by yourself. Yeah. Uh-huh, uh-huh. So, can I hear this? Very clean, and you're kind of popping out the first one, you keep the direction going through, right? All the way through. And then this same thing. Just super, start super soft and clean and clear, and then as you get louder, you can get more on. So the variety of the stroke can help you, but if you're always kind of in between, then you don't have that, that tool where you can make it crisp and longer. It's just always kind of in between, you know what I mean? So I'm a big fan of like making it very concise and short, but definitely fast. Yeah, if you get too fast, somebody will tell you, I mean, somebody already told you, but yeah. But if it's clean, nope, I think it'll be good, yeah. It's just when your left hand doesn't have the energy, if you're sacrificing the cleanliness for the speed, that's not good. But I think you can do it if you just give your left hand a little attention, a little energy. Yeah, but great job. Yeah.